Volume 2, Chapter 9. Forced into the tiger's den, Feng Ming armed himself with courage and stepped with his best foot forwards to bite the bullet. Upon entering the building and making his way into the inner chambers, he was welcomed by warmth. The air inside was laced with a distinct smoky scent. It was the smell of aromatic incense. Feng Ming felt like he was visiting a Buddhist temple. The air was thick, but the smell was rather pleasant. Listening carefully, Feng Ming caught the sound of a water flow hidden in his surroundings. It created a serene and calm atmosphere. He continued his way until he finally reached the inner sanctum. His eyes rested on three individuals, sitting casually in the main room. An attractive woman sat in between two men. She was wearing a deep plum-colored dress. The design of her outfit was long and graceful. The cuffs of her sleeves were decorated by extremely detailed trims and patterns. Her cheeks were naturally a shade of peach blush, and her eyes were as sharp and bright as lacquer. There was no doubt in Feng Ming's mind that she was the third princess. She was really living up to her rumored beauty. He was used to seeing pretty girls on television, nonetheless he had his fair share at admiring beauties from all over the world. However, she was a rare specimen in this ancient world. He nodded slightly in appreciation but didn't feel embarrassed about his eyes lingering on her. The princess's personal attendants were standing to the side of the room. Fen Yan stood near her master. All of them were observing Feng Ming secretly, and they were bewildered by the prince's calm composure and the fact that he didn't intend to intrude. Official Xia was right on the money. The two men accompanying his aunt were indeed the kingly Ruo Yan and the math genius Master Dong. The trio sat around a sand pit, purposely installed for etching their discussions and calculations. Master Dong appeared quite brutish, grizzly, and unkempt. The man had a big upturned pompous nose. Feng Ming never would have guessed the man was a genius if he had passed him on the streets. The old man was holding a bamboo pole in his hand, and was occupied with drawing and discussing his work. The third princess was completely caught by the lecture, her head bobbed as she processed the information. Looking at Ruo Yan, Feng Ming figured the king was in his 20s, appearing mature. Feng Ming guessed he was perhaps around 27 or 8. His appearance was nothing special, and at his waist was a very modest-looking sword. If it wasn't for Lai Er's and official Xia's warnings, Feng Ming wouldn't have felt Ruo Yan was much of a threat. To be honest, he really couldn't see how the man was anything to be reckoned with. The prince continued to monitor the proceedings of the party he wasn't really invited to. He didn't want to ruin the happy atmosphere. He guessed that the moment he opened his mouth and interrupted the exchange of knowledge, he would be immediately escorted out for his impertinence. It was cold outside, and having to brace the chilly winter wind again wasn't on his menu. Knowing better, he resigned and chose to quietly wait in the sidelines. He found a seat and settled himself down. From his location, he sat listening in and playing the role of the obedient and respectful youngster. Master Dong's voice was very light, and everything that left his mouth was professional jargon. Feng Ming barely even understood half the sentences that the man spoke. The prince basically continued to rot away in the shadows for almost an hour. Boredom was one of his worst enemies, and this was a cruel. He cursed inwardly, he suffered in silence. Thinking to himself, he should have marched right in and announced himself to the princess to save his current brain-punishing weight. But no, he wanted to look generous and caring. By not crashing the class, only God knows how long he would have to wait until he gains an audience with his aunt. Ancient people were terrible at interpersonal management. It was obvious they placed little value on people's precious time. Fan Jia and Xi Rei currently aren't in the best part of their political buddy relationship. One would have thought matters of a country would be more important than minor discussions about math's theorems. In a rare moment, Master Dong finally came to a pause as he finished a long-winded explanation. Seeing the man's mouth finally shut for the first time, Feng Ming let out a heavy sigh. The prince gathered his wits and motioned to leave his perch, believing now was the opportunity to finally greet the princess. Instead, he was shot down before even having his bottom off his seat. The princess pulled the scholar back into discussion. Master Dong, the tools you've discussed appear naturally easy to use, but being able to digest the reasoning behind them is a very complex process. On a national level, it would take a lot of manpower to teach the basics. The old man replied, Your Highness is correct. However, I have studied numerous math tools used for solving advanced mathematics. Each has their pros and cons. Even if they are simple, they might not be sufficiently precise, and some tools, although accurate, can be extremely complicated. This tool is now regularly used in the Li Palace, and has been proven time after time as the best candidate for solving complex problems that we have. It would take a month or two for the most talented to master the use. Feng Ming rolled his eyes and groaned to himself. They were starting their talk again. Unknown to Feng Ming, once he had entered the room, Ruo Yan had paid very close attention to him. The king caught Feng Ming's soft disgruntled sound and gave the boy a fleeting glance. Ruo Yan's lips curled into an amused smile. With a touch of arrogance he suddenly spoke, "I've heard of Xi Rei's King Rong's capabilities in mathematics. Perhaps the crowned prince is well learned in this area. Does the prince have any opinions on Master Dong's new calculating tools?" The King of Li's sudden bidding towards the outsider immediately brought all eyes onto the prince. Catching him off guard, Feng Ming quickly arranged his composure and sat with his back as straight as plank. How the hell was he to know anything about number theorems? Instead of answering the king's request, he pushed the question aside and took advantage of this moment to grab the princess's attention. Feng Ming flashed his aunt a big warm smile. He stood up and moved towards the three and gave her the proper greetings, kneeling on one knee with his hands clasped and raised to the level of his head. "And he is here to visit his royal aunt." The third princess simply replied nonchalantly, "Prince, please rise, you have traveled from afar, it must have been very tough." Feng Ming was genuinely surprised that their meeting would be very civil, and there was no mention of the death of her husband, An Sun. A bit dazed by her reaction, Feng Ming returned to his seat, his eyes focused on his aunt. "Royal aunt, and he has traveled to escort you back to Xi Rei, and he will definitely treat auntie as his own mother. Would your highness promise to return with me?" An Sun traveled to Xi Rei in order to claim the throne, and my father has deployed troops from Fanjia to Xi Rei in our country's best interests. For the crowned prince to travel under a peaceful notion over a great distance, it is highly unlikely that you only want to welcome a stranger to move to Xi Rei. For all this trouble, what is the true reason for coming here?" The princess's eyes turned towards the surface of the sandbox, her gaze looked beyond the granules. As if deep underneath the pile of sand, she had hidden away her treasures and joys. Her red lips parted, "If all your efforts are just for the sake of obtaining power and wealth, then it is exhausted. Such earthly measures are always changing. Isn't it better to invest your time in creating ageless and unbreakable laws and theorems for mathematics? What do you say, crowned prince, am I correct?" Feng Ming was silent for a good length of time. He would have never thought the princess would have such views on politics and that she was this fanatic and passionate about math. The prince didn't know how to respond. Ruo Yan stole the spotlight and praised the woman, "Princess certainly has a lot of experience and your innate talent is extraordinary. Ruo Yan has heard of princess's intelligence and wisdom for many years. Today I have taken the liberty to propose to you. Naturally, you would become my queen. Princess's identity is highly praised and befitting of the position, no one would dare oppose my selection. You shall not be disturbed or challenged for your interests. In fact, you will be free to research and develop at your own pace. Furthermore, Master Dong will be there to aid your learning. You will be able to excel and become a master yourself. With me by your side day and night, how can this not be paradise on earth?" Master Dong quickly affirmed his king's claims, "That is correct. This old man would be able to teach you whilst you are in the country of Li. If this was to happen, it would be a joy to all." These remarks were obviously attempts to impress the princess and win her heart. The princess turned her eyes to briefly study the king's face before returning her attention back onto the sand. Feng Ming's alarms were blowing off. Ever since he set out for Fanjia, official Xia had given him plenty of leads and taught him how to deal with certain situations if they were to arise. However, the matter of Ruo Yan proposing marriage to the third princess so quickly and without shame came as a big surprise. Feng Ming didn't have any backup plan up his sleeve to counter this situation. It was easy, right? He had one objective, and that was to ensure the proposal does not succeed. It was evident that the princess's heart was wavering and she was contemplating the idea. Thus, in a rush to put a halt in Ruo Yan's plan, Feng Ming interjected with a sounding shout. "No way, that's impossible." Letting out his roar, all eyes diverted their attention onto him again. As soon as he opened his mouth, Ruo Yan's deep gaze fixated on him. This time there was a strange flash in the man's eyes. They were pinning him down like a vicious tiger waiting to shred its prey to bits. Feng Ming was breaking out in a cold sweat. No wonder everyone warned him to watch out for Ruo Yan. The fear he struck in people with just his powerful gaze alone was enough to live up to his reputation. The king's sharp eyes switched and the tense moment slipped away as his face softened and broke into a smile before gently asking, "Prince and he, are you implying that the third princess is forbidden to marry me?" Feng Ming's back was literally drenched with sweat by now. He gritted his teeth and stood his ground by replying, "That's not what I meant. Considering Auntie is obsessed with math, she should be returning with an he to Xi Rei. Xi Rei is well known for excelling in academics, including math. Thus it is more suitable for Her Highness to study in Xi Rei." Desperate times called for desperate measures. Feng Ming had no idea whether Xi Rei was known for arithmetic. He was pulling the claim completely out of thin air, God help him. Master Dong immediately laughed out loud and sneered before turning a blind eye on the boy's mistake. The third princess looked at Feng Ming with scorn. Mathematics was her life's passion and people making false claims wouldn't pass lightly under her judgment. Her expression darkened. "Prince and he, you should pick your words carefully. Everyone knows that the country with the title of most advanced knowledge in this area of study belongs to the country of Li. Naturally, Master Dong is the highest ranked scholar in this field. For the sake of coaxing me to follow you home to Xi Rei, why would you give me such false words?" Feng Ming's face turned beet red. The king's piercing eyes enjoyed every bit of humiliation the prince was feeling. The boy's pretty face blushing caught the tiger's attention. The king felt something in his heart for a very short moment before coughing. His eyes remained on the boy. "Since the crown prince is so proud of Xi Rei's advancements, perhaps prince and he would like to demonstrate math tools currently used in Xi Rei." The kings didn't offer him a friendly invitation. It was a trap purposely and thoughtfully organized to ridicule him. If Feng Ming was to discuss theories with Master Dong up front, it would result in nothing but a mess. Feng Ming stared at the carpet in front of him. He was anxious to find a way out of this trap. Walking over hot bricks, he forced himself to think hard and fast of any modern knowledge that could rescue him from this potential disaster. Tools weren't a big problem, but the only issue was he was only familiar with using a computer or a calculator. Where was he going to find one in this archaic world? With a stroke of luck, Feng Ming had given Fen Yan a good impression. The maidservant threw him a lifeline. Leaving her post, she kneeled beside her master and whispered softly into her ear, "Your Highness, Master Dong is here. It is natural that Prince and he would feel intimidated by his presence. Perhaps a private audience with you tomorrow, he would be more comfortable in sharing his knowledge with Your Highness." The princess glanced over to her nephew. Indeed, the poor boy was sweating in discomfort, feeling that he had learned his lesson. She was about to nod and pardon him, only to be interrupted by Feng Ming's loud shriek. The prince leaped into the air, bolting towards the trio, and was barely able to contain himself, shouting, "I've got it! I've got it!" The unwarranted outburst stunned everyone. Feng Ming ignored everyone's reaction and instead danced excitedly in front of his aunt. "The best tool for the trade, I've got it." A big smile eased across his face before he furthered, "To be able to use it, I need to first ask Your Highness for a few important things." "Oh." The princess was taken aback. "What do you need?" "I'll need about 50 perforated pearls, 10 gold thin wires and 2 strips of wood." "Don't you need a wooden block?" she asked. "I don't need one." During this era, the majority of tools used for complex map were designed based on algorithms engraved into a wooden surface. Everyone in the room was surprised that Feng Ming would not be requiring any carving tools or a wooden base. The princess was genuinely curious to what Feng Ming was going to do with pearls, wire, and flimsy bits of wood. Regardless, she had her servants fetch the materials. Once gathered and passed to the prince, he quickly threaded the pearls into strings with the gold wire and tied the ends to the strips of wood. Laying his work gently on the ground, he finally declared happily, "This is it? The tool that has lasted throughout the ages." Even when the Westerners were shown this, they were amazed by this invention. With quick thinking, Feng Ming managed to improvise a very simple abacus. The third princess was at the edge of her seat, her eyes locking down on the strange contraption. "How does this thing work?" Even the king was intrigued. The older man peered curiously to the same spot before glancing up at the prince. His eyes lingered on the boy's smiling red lips. Ruo Yin coldly snickered, "Such a pitiful looking tool, it's quite laughable." Despite the king's attempt to downplay this unseen invention, Master Dong studied the contraption before concluding, turning his focus on the prince. "This device may seem simple, but how it can be used baffles me. Please, Prince and he enlighten us and explain the theory behind the usage." The scholar's tone was very different from the rough reception Feng Ming had first received. Feng Ming tried to hide his victorious grin. Who would have thought? A tool that has existed in China for over 1,000 years and still used in the modern world would completely stump a genius. He cleared his throat and looked at the third princess, offering her a smile to melt her heart, if her highness would state a problem. What do you mean? Such as addition or subtraction, for instance 188 plus 397 equals. Feng Ming explained triumphantly. Soon he found the atmosphere changed. The third princess gave him a strange look. Such a simple calculation, why would you even use a tool? What? Feng Ming replied. Had he made the mistake to assume that the people of this world was very backwards in terms of arithmetic knowledge? Perhaps they have already established a tool that was on par with the capabilities of an abacus? He was sinking deeper into his own trap. What other tool was there apart from an abacus? Sweat was breaking out again. The tension between the study group dropped, the princess was unimpressed, and Ruo Yan sneered as the prince was making a spectacular mess of himself. Only Master Dong appeared to be interested in what Feng Ming had to say. This was looking bad. Feng Ming had boasted so loud and proud about his invention, to retreat at this moment would only mean shame. Feng Ming wiped his forehead with his sleeve, he gritted his teeth before pulling out his last cards. Well then, if I could request the third princess for a subject for me to solve? The abacus looks dainty, but there's no problem on heaven and earth that this won't be able to find an answer to. He thought to himself. If she gives me one that's completely out of my range, I'll claim that only King Rong would be able to solve it with an abacus, thus I'll try and convince her she REI is the best place for her. The princess obliged, given how confident the prince made himself out to be. Although a still skeptical, she nodded and said. All right, I have a good question for you. Suddenly, the crowd's attention focused on her lips. Feng Ming was especially nervous, his eyes didn't even blink in anticipation. Whilst the prince had his attention on his aunt, he was oblivious to the pair of intense sharp eyes that targeted him. The problem is. Volume 2, Chapter 10. Well, my question is, the princess paused, cutting off mid-sentence. Her eyes glimmered, they had an aura of elegance and it was without a doubt they were beautiful like the rest of her. She released a soft laugh. Feng Ming consulted with his inner conscience. His aunt was one fine-looking widow thanks to Unsun's blood on his hands. It will be such a pity to destroy her second spring. With that thought, Feng Ming flashed his eyes onto the King of Li. This proved to be an untimely mistake on the prince's behalf. The very moment he turned to face the man, their eyes locked. The king's gaze was sharp as the tip of a blade, and they did a great job of piercing into the prince. Feng Ming could easily imagine electric sparks streaming from the man's eyes. Rong Tian's gaze had the same level of electrifying intensity, however, it was different. Feng Ming would turn into gooey hot mess, his heart and brain would be completely flustered, as if he had accidentally poked his finger into a power socket. Instead, Ruo Yan's gaze was startling, like cracks of lightning, and once he struck, you were left surrounded by a harsh chill. The unfriendly gesture was etched into Feng Ming's mind. He couldn't help but break into a cold sweat. Feng Ming never knew that a man could send him trembling with unease by the mere use of his eyes. The pinning stare lasted for a brief moment, although the effects lingered on the prince. Ruo Yan switched on a more amicable look and nodded in acknowledgement to the prince. The king's action sent every last strand of hair standing on his body. Feng Ming shifted from his spot from discomfort. As he backed away, he felt a tug on his sleeves. Prince. Feng Yan asked gently. Huh. The maid gave him a giggle. Prince and he, the third princess has given her question to you. Oh. Feng Ming was amazed by his own absent-mindedness. Any reason to break away from Ruo Yan's line of fire was good at this point. Feng Ming pulled his sleeves down and patted the beads of sweat from his forehead before turning his attention back to the princess. The princess's observant eyes noticed her nephew's paled complexion. With a frown she continued, why is the prince in a panic? She thought for a moment, before advising, as for the question I have set for you, there is currently no defined method to resolve an answer efficiently. Nor has anyone come close to solving the problem. Therefore, it is completely understandable that answering this question on the spur of the moment is beyond your capabilities. Reassuring his aunt that this challenge was the last of his problems, Feng Ming replied, I'm fine, I'm just feeling a bit cold. With that said, he automatically turned his attention to the sand pit. The question installed for him was neatly drawn out with a bamboo stick. Studying closer, his aunt had drawn a perfect circle, almost as if she had drawn it with a compass. The audience were all focused on the shape in front of them. It was clear that the topic was centric around a circle. Feng Ming frowned. A circle? Don't tell me you want me to find the circumference of a circle or the area of one. Now he was secretly kicking himself on the inside for not listening. He might as well play the fool, royal auntie, forgive me, as for the question, and he did not understand clearly, could you inform me again? The third princess was surprised to see Feng Ming's persistence. She stated, the prince must be well acquainted with this area of mathematics to have such confidence in a topic with little negativity. Eck? Feng Ming had a gut feeling that he was supposed to know the question just by looking at the shape she drew. Is this how the ancient folk set out questions? What does she want me to answer? Fortunately for Feng Ming, Lady Luck was smiling on him. Fen Yan, out of kindness, whispered softly just within his ear's reach. Your Highness, the third princess requested the calculation of how many granules of sand does it take to fill a globe. In the end, Feng Ming's worst concerns were coming true. Even in this era, mathematics was well developed. The young man quickly forced himself to think quickly. A bolt of lightning struck his thoughts as he realized, the question was basically asking him, how to work out the volume of a sphere. He laughed inwardly, isn't this a piece of cake? Given relief, Feng Ming's tensed muscles could finally relax. The prince offered his eager audience a smile before blurting, well, if it is this question, it is rather simple. If one seeks the volume of a sphere, it can easily be solved by a formula. First we will need to know the radius, and the formula is 4/3 multiplied by pi and further multiplied by radius cubed. Feng Ming had answered nonchalantly, as if it was the simplest problem he had encountered. Everyone in the room was surprised. The princess' face was painted with confusion. She queried, and cannot follow your prompts, what's clap? And what's a? What did you mean by 4/3 and cubed? It's quite simple. If Ant would review what I have mentioned here. Feng Ming grabbed the bamboo pole and etched in the formula on the surface of the sand. He drew a line from the center of the circle that extended to the edge to represent the radius. He patiently explained, this line is given the name r, and pi is roughly a number valued at 3.14159, and cubed indicates a value to the power of 3. 4/3 is the same as 4 parts divided by 3. Feng Ming was very fortunate that during his younger years he'd often get punished writing out formulas by his maths teacher. Now, not only did he retain his knowledge for a broad range of formulas, he could explain them in a detailed manner. This was sufficient to pull off his stunt of a maths genius. Fen Yan was astonished how the belittled prince had instantaneously managed to captivate everyone's attention. All eyes in the room was drawn to where he had made scribbles during his lecture. Master Dong was wide-eyed and eager. It was clear the man was still trying to process this newfound information. The man's jaw coated with a gray-bearded jittered. Naturally, as a proud researcher in the field, Master Dong's first reaction was to send a servant to retrieve measurement tools, so he could immediately exercise Feng Ming's solution. He wanted to test whether such profound formula would solve this challenge. Prior to the prince's induction, as part of his research, Master Dong had manually quantified the number of sand granules in a given sphere. However, this was a primitive method, and an attempt to work backwards trying to find any patterns in the numbers. They had simply filled certain spheres with their capable volume of sand. The contents of the spheres were measured in pre-weighed boxes. This tedious manner was carried out over various sizes of containers. When brush and paper arrived, Master Dong jotted down the calculations and found that Feng Ming's formula gave the same answer to his research. This affirmed, Feng Ming was a serious contender. The faces of the third princess and Master Dong could only be described as shocked. Both of them were true enthusiasts of the art of arithmetic, studying countless years and placing their souls into research. Seeing such an unearthly challenge resolved before their very eyes, they could only stand in awe. It was truly a heaven-sent moment, and both were extremely touched by the turn of events. Master Dong choked on his words as he struggled to make a coherent sentence. Third princess, this is really the same as our manual quantification. The third princess's face was still suspended in disbelief. The quick pace at which Feng Ming provided the answer to a baffling problem left her feeling flustered. A blush washed across her cheeks, as if she was being coy with a sweetheart. The princess turned her head suddenly towards her maidservant, Fen Yan. Quickly, go retrieve a brush, ink, and paper. Record everything. And her servant made a wild dash to bid her master's orders. Returning her attention onto her nephew, Her face glowed with anticipation. Prince, seems like your talents as a mathematician was underestimated. There are countless questions which has not been solved, and yet to witness a solution to one unraveled before my very eyes, there is nothing I can offer in return. Please, Prince, accept my gratitude and respect. The woman immediately dropped to her knees, giving him a deep prostrate bow. Feng Ming snapped into action, please aunt, and he does is not deserving of your praise. Not in a million years would Feng Ming foresee the princess to be enwrapped to this extent, and at once helped her back onto her feet. As he was supporting his aunt to stand upright, Master Dong had followed suit out of excitement. The old man's eyes brimmed with tears of joy. Old Dong, was also very disrespectful to your highness. Please forgive my rudeness. The old man knelt on his knees and offered him a deep bow. Feng Ming's face was red as a tomato, given that he was trying to preserve a bit of modesty, but it was a tough job as he had to help people back onto their feet left and right. Please, don't mind me. Please rise. Feng Ming muttered slightly abashed. Whilst this took place, Ruo Yan sat as the silent bystander with his sharp watchful eyes. After much trouble and chaos, everyone finally returned to their seats that surrounded the sandbox. The third princess was still rallied with energy. She couldn't resist issuing another question. This formula is certainly advanced, even for our current standing in mathematics. Can Prince explain how we can apply the abacus for calculations? Indeed, such a clever tool. If old Dong could have the privilege of understanding the mechanisms, he would certainly die a happy man. Master Dong chimed in. Feng Ming had actually forgotten about the abacus he had boosted about, the contraption laid undisturbed in the middle of the room. Sure, he could pull off basic calculations with addition and subtraction. However, he had never used the abacus for complex calculations. How was he going to give them an answer? Master Dong waited for a response enthusiastically, but sensing hesitation from the prince, he gave his own question a thought and suddenly realized, oh, this is Xi Rei's invention. If the prince is uncomfortable with sharing the country's secret knowledge, then please refrain from obliging. One could read disappointment stamped all over the third princess's face, and her feelings were made clear by her silence. At this moment, it wasn't good to offend the princess. This would mean taking a step back to square one. So far, Feng Ming and his blunders have managed to make great progress, and it was best to exploit this avenue whilst it was still active. He had to get his aunt to promise to return with him after his own experience with Ruo Yan. Although short, he was very sure that the King of Li was in fact a terrifying man and the princess would probably be better off not marrying him. Given this circumstance, a bright spark flashed inside Feng Ming's mind. He dipped his head down, thinking for a short while before returning his attention to the crowd around him. A triumphant and charming smile eased across his lips. He arose from his seat and looked at his audience. This included making eye contact with Ruo Yan. This was the second time their eyes met, although it was momentary, it wasn't any easier than the first. Feng Ming's heart was erratic and in distress even with the short contact. However, this time he managed to switch on a calm facade. His face remained indifferent, as if he was brushing the negative vibes off effortlessly. Finally, his eyes settled on the face of his aunt. With an air of elegance, he brought his hands clasped together to give her a greeting of obeisance. With a tone of deference, he reasoned, in truth, he cannot be fully credited for the formula demonstrated today. My explanation is only partial. In fact, King Rong was the one who created this formula. I'm unclear in which methods he used to create such a solution. However, this shouldn't matter, as upon returning to Xi Rei, Auntie would have plenty of time to confer with the regent king. Naturally, Master Dong is also welcome to join us in Xi Rei. An aggregation of the smartest people in the field solving all these earthly challenges is a rare opportunity, and our findings would be a blessing from the heavens. Feng Ming had thrown the silly old man a lifeline. Seeing that he was winning in this tug of war, he did him a favor and offered to save him from Ruo Yan's clutches. Once Feng Ming had finished announcing his offer, the princess was on the edge of her seat. No one could argue that the prince's invitation to join a league of scholars to combat difficult challenges in her beloved field of studies was extremely attractive. In contrast, Ruo Yan's offer was waning in prestige. The princess worded her response tactfully. As Ruo Yan was still present, she replied faintly. Thank you, Prince, I have heard of Xi Rei's regent king's feats over many matters. It would truly be a splendid experience to witness his abilities for problem solving firsthand. It was clear on where the princess's sentiments lay, After this confrontation, Ruo Yan knew he was out of the game, in terms of mathematics. He retained his noble demeanor and offered the princess a slight smile, and didn't pursue the matter vocally. The king pinned his eyes onto Feng Ming. His glare was alike sharp arrows piercing into the prince, the only person to obstruct his objectives. Feng Ming had also been keeping tabs on the King of Li in the corner of his eyes. For the ill-back-digging look he was receiving, Feng Ming could only wish he could return it with equal animosity. However, he was afraid as having the man's cold stare linger on him, made him feel like a frog in the vicinity of a viper, ready to pounce onto a meal. He was frozen to the ground. Hearing the princess's positive response gave him relief, at least he managed to accomplish half of his goals. It was best he stayed clear of Ruo Yan and search for means to seal the deal later on. Finding a reason to end his discomfort, he quickly cupped his hands again and directed to his aunt, "To trouble my aunt today for such a long time, and he is best to take his leave." The princess and Master Dong didn't hide their expressions of dismay, as both were unwilling to let go of the prince from their discussion. His aunt exclaimed, "Prince, you are leaving so soon." "That's right, this old man has many questions pertaining to this subject to discuss." Feng Ming was beginning to feel like a pincushion, and Ruo Yan was the one doing the stabbing. No one in their right mind would stand around and subject themselves to this psychological pressure. Feng Ming waved his hands in protest, "My apologies, I have matters to attend to, and he will make sure to visit another time." Seeing the situation was helpless, the princess stood up and personally saw her guest out of her manner. Shortly, General Tong and the rest of his entourage made their way out from the waiting room where they had spent most of their time resting and drinking tea. The party met in front of the main gates. It was a promising sight, when the third princess stepped out and attentively saw off her nephew to the door. Regardless, everyone inwardly felt that there was something strange about what had happened. After climbing into the horse-drawn carriage, not only Lai Er but official Xia had squeezed into the small space to accompany the prince. The only one riding a horse was General Tong, as his stature was a bit too big to be welcomed into the carriage. The first words to leave official Xia's mouth when he scooted into the chamber were, "Congratulations, Prince. Prince certainly has God-sent powers, to be able to win over the third princess and persuade her to side with Xi Rei." Feng Ming flashed him a grin, "What gave it away?" Lai Er interjected, "It's really obvious, it's her attitude towards you. Prior and after, who can't tell the difference? Furthermore, Li's king, Ruo Yan gives off an unfavorable feeling, and his appearance is not very attractive. Perhaps he failed in his attempt to propose a marriage on that basis. Recognition must be given to the prince's courage." This humble Xia had suspected that due to prince's youth, prince may not be able to stand his ground whilst facing such a fearful man. "It appears my concerns were unrequired." The zany old man let out a hearty chuckle, giving a nod of acknowledgement to Feng Ming. Feng Ming thought of Ruo Yan, his brain flooded with the overbearing weight the man imposed onto him just by staring at him. He shuddered at recalling the scene. He shook his head and grumbled bitterly, "Don't mention him again, that man is horrible. When I'm near him I can't help but tremble." His face pulled strange expressions as if he was trying to get a bad taste out of his mouth. Nonetheless, in the end Ruo Yan could not match up with Prince's brilliant streak of tact. He was unable to capture the heart and mind of the third princess. "That's right, how did Prince coerce the princess? What kind of clever trick did you employ? And how did you deal with Ruo Yan?" It was going to be a long story from start to finish, so Feng Ming did his best and incorporated gestures with his hands and makeshift drawings on the ground, giving very animated detail as the group traveled back to their stay. Both Lai Er and official Xia were infatuated with every minor detail, and at the end they couldn't help but cheer and applaud the prince's moves. As the debriefing concluded, official Xia sighed, "Xia knew King Rong was well versed in history, geography, and astronomy. I did not expect him to have reached such a high plateau in the field of mathematics." This statement clicked with Feng Ming, considering he fabricated this lie for the sake of boosting Xi Rei's credentials, he giggled to himself. In a short time, the fleet had made their way back to the hotel. Inside, Chu Lan and the rest of his servants had awaited their return for the whole day. Hearing the bustle of their master's return, they ran eagerly to greet him outside. The prince was welcomed with the smiling faces of his three closest maids. Each of them ushered him inside, and helped him change into his indoor outfit. Chu Lan praised, "Congratulations, prince, in a few days we will be able to escort the third princess back to Xi Rei. If news reaches King Rong, He would be certainly happy of your success. How did you guys know? Feng Ming was surprised. Word certainly leaked out fast. He hadn't even mentioned it to the girls. Chu Xing was straightforwards, nodding with a grin. Naturally, because our prince is suave, outstanding, and charming, he has no match in the world. It is only right that the princess would return with us. Oh please, Chu Xing. We used those words yesterday. You should find something fresh to say. Chu Xing pouted. I'm only speaking the truth. Every day His Highness is very charming, therefore we can say it on a daily basis. Chu Lan, it's not my fault you decide to read official Xia's and General Tang's faces to figure out that it is good news. What does that say about your taste? Feng Ming laughed at the petty bickering and decided to do some damage control by raising his hands. Okay, alright, that's enough. We've managed to pull today off without much of a hitch. We should be able to return to Xi'ai quite soon. We should all be happy. With that statement, the three maids giggled and steered the conversation into gossip and curious ramblings. Questions such as what the princess looked like and whether she lived up to rumor were first on the agenda. The hotel was filled with chatter and laughter. Volume 2, Chapter 11 to 12. The next day, the weather suddenly intensified and the chills soon turned into icy deposits. The courtyards were now heavily cloaked with a thick layer of snow. Early in the morning, Gui Shen had made his way to visit the country's important guests at their stay. Perhaps it was an unspoken standard for Fan Jia, even the men of were not an exception to the rule of beauty. Gui Shen had presented himself, dressed head to toe in black. Even his cape was made from a glimmering material that was jet black. Gui Shen's pale skin was translucent and flushed with blood from bracing the cold. His complexion matched the flakes of snow that he had gathered on his cape. One couldn't deny that he was handsome and elegant under a certain light, and his presence demanded brilliance. Feng Ming had originally intended to hibernate longer in his cozy bed. However, his plans were disrupted when Chu Lan and his two other maids tugged the weary prince out of bed, and he certainly didn't go without a fight. When they eventually dragged him out, they assisted the prince in making himself presentable to his guest. Naturally, it was best if he received his visitor than keeping him at bay. You are quite an early bird, my royal uncle-in-law. When Feng Ming stepped out from his private quarters, he was greeted with the sight of Gui Shen sitting casually sipping on a cup of tea. Feng Ming cupped his hands together and raised them to bid the man a greeting of respect. Feng Ming had woken from slumber, and was content with staying warm and toasty indoors, hence there was no plans to leave this comfort. Naturally, he was dressed for the occasion, adorning an exquisite purple silken gown. His neck, wrists, and waist were girded with trimmings from a deer pelt that Chu Lan had especially chosen to complement his outfit. Even though what he was wearing was decided on the spur of the moment, Feng Ming pulled it off with grace and a noble temperament which was very unique to his overall appearance. Upon lifting his head to look at the prince, Gui Shen's eyes lit up. He arose from his seat and grinned. Gui Shen has purposely paid a visit to congratulate Prince and he. Yesterday, Prince's unparalleled talents and prestige has already made the third princess yield. The display you made has awakened a yearning in the third princess, persuading her heart towards Xi'ai. The third princess has expressed her wishes to our great king, so that she may be able to return to Xi'ai with the prince's entourage. To everyone's surprise, the turn of events was running very smoothly. No one would have fathomed that the third princess would scramble to seal the deal at such a lightning pace. All that escaped Feng Ming's lip was a stunned noise, ah. He turned his head towards official Xia and General Tong, and they both had an equal expression of disbelief drawn on their faces. Additionally, the king believes that the death of An Sun and Xi'ai's involvement should be pardoned, hence, the king has already given orders to Fan Jia's army to immediately withdraw. In an unhurried manner, Gui Shen gave the foreign group the most important piece of news. General Tong laughed out wholeheartedly, clapping in delight and proclaiming, "This is great." Official Xia saluted Gui Shen, and sincerely spoke, "Thanks to the generous assistance of King Gui Shen, otherwise our success would have not been possible. Xi'ai will never forget your highness's benevolence." Gui Shen returned with a smile, shaking his head in denial of his part, "You flatter me." Gui Shen naturally had to help family. The modest man turned towards Feng Ming and in an amicable manner told him, 3 days later, the king will personally summon the prince and invited to a grand feast. Meanwhile, for the next 2 days, Prince and he can enjoy his time and appreciate Fan Jia's winterscape. How does it sound if Gui Shen introduce you to areas of interest? Feng Ming didn't really have anything he could or could not do whilst he was in Fangjia, but hearing that he would be able to go out and play, he quickly recalled Gui Sen's fine-looking stallion he had met earlier and was just about to nod his head when Lai Er interrupted. "Prince, during these next 2 days perhaps we can slip out and head off and blend in, so we can try out all the delicacies amongst the civilians?" Official Xia immediately continued, "Ah, that's right, if everybody knew that we are an envoy from Xi'ari, then we won't be able to experience the everyday lifestyles of the people in Fangjia. We'd certainly miss out on the daily customs. If this is what you'd like, naturally I can take the prince to visit the commoners." Lai Er interjected with a dubiously statement whilst smiling, "Your Highness, you stand out with your impressive demeanor and you are well recognized in this country. How would you be able to play a meager civilian?" Gui Sen face blanked, "If that's the case, then perhaps Gui Sen will not accompany the prince." The older man turned to give Lai Er a disdained look before directing his attention to Feng Ming. In semi-scathing voice he finished, "Prince, Gui Sen has other matters to attend to today, I shall take my leave." Once Gui Sen was out of sight, Feng Ming scratched his head and swiveled to focus his confusion onto his servants. His face scrunched up in a frown, "For what reason were you all treating Gui Sen with such a terrible attitude? He was going out of his way in kindness to accompany me. Perhaps I would have even had the chance to get his permission to ride his horse." Official Xia kept an enigmatic expression on his face as he patted his whiskers and persisted in his silence. Lai Er ignored Feng Ming's antagonizing glare, and for a while he didn't reply, but he finally answered with a degree of respect for his master, "Prince, Gui Sen only ran into a snag yesterday and he was completely dejected and depressed, so why would he appear normal to give us good tidings?" "I don't know." Feng Ming was perplexed with what he was meant to be getting from Lai Er's words, and he wasn't ashamed to ask his subordinate the answer, "Tell me why." Lai Er stole a furtive glance at Official Xia, and offered the prince a smile in return for all the pressing, "I'm just a lowly servant, how would I know? However, Official Xia should certainly know." Feng Ming immediately placed his attention to the old man. Under many sets of watchful eyes, Official Xia paused in his therapeutic strokes of his whiskers. Sighing, he finally submitted, "The third princess is excessively impatient. Gui Sen is overly enthusiastic about it all, and the great king of Fangjia is acting too warm towards us. There is certainly something wrong under these circumstances. Old Xia is currently unable to digest the inner workings of this dilemma. However, it is not a simple one. Prince must take caution and proceed with care." General Tong reinforced, "That's right, Fangjia is very different from Xilei. Prince absolutely cannot leave this building at will." Inwardly Feng Ming cursed, "Even if I was in Xilei, I couldn't even leave my quarters at whim." Seeing everyone keep a grave expression on their faces, Feng Ming couldn't help but feel a sense of fear. He arched his shoulders in discomfort and scolded, "All right, everything is always suspicious, did King Rong send you to scare me on his behalf?" After all, he knew something was wrong with the smooth sailing he was riding, so he could only be obedient and stay in the hotel, only to watch the snow fall onto the landscape from his window. Chu Lan, Chu Xing, Chu Yu, and Lai Er accompanied him by playing and keeping the prince entertained. General Tong and his men remained indoors to secure the premise and only Official Xia slipped out to carry out business. No one knew what he was getting up to. When night fell, Official Xia scuttled back in a hurry. General Tong immediately pulled the old man aside, and the two spent what seemed forever, exchanging whispers in a private area. Feng Ming and Lai Er received news of Official Xia's return, and the two young men caught sight of the engaged pair and quickly joined the party. "Official Xia," the prince prompted. The advisor abruptly turned to the prince and gave him a polite salute, "Oh, your royal highness. Official Xia, you've been absent all day." "That's right, and it has been quite rewarding." The old man stroked his beard, and motioned his audience to settle down on a seat around him so he could divulge closer details of his new insights. "There are two matters at hand. Firstly, the informants I have sent have returned. It appears that last night, the great king of Fangjia suddenly fell ill to a strange disease. He almost died in the morning and it has been a miracle that he has recovered. After his brush with death, he immediately summoned the third princess to his palace." Feng Ming's eyes wedged wide open, he scratched his head in disbelief, to knock on death's door the night before and to be soundly alive by the morning. "Hey, it looks like Fangjia's medicine is well developed." He swiveled quickly to Lai Er and made a note, Sometime before we head back to Xi'erei, we should make sure we recruit a Taiyi from Fanjia to take with us. Lai Er shook his head in disapproval. In terms of medicinal studies and knowledge in this world, is there anyone that could match official Xia's expertise in this area? There's certainly something suspicious about this situation. Everyone was on common ground with that idea, all their eyes focused on official Xia in anticipation. The old man nodded, indeed, not that I wish to gloat. According to old Xia's experiences, the king's illness has only been countered temporarily. Rather, his health is like an arrow at the end of its flight. In less than 3 days, Fan Jia may be mourning at his funeral. Feng Ming let out a startling shout. What? That, can't, the king of Fan Jia is hosting our farewell banquet exactly 3 days later. Lai Er remained calm. He dipped his head in thought before asking the trusted advisor, Official Xia, how can you be so certain that the king of Fan Jia would die? Official Xia stood proudly and fondled his beard, giving off a slight smile. According to my inquiries into Fan Jia King's symptoms, it appears that this was not a sudden impact from an unknown serious illness. In fact, all his symptoms are akin to that of being poisoned over a long duration. It is only coincidental that his symptoms flared to life-threatening levels in the past day. To the best of my estimations, he has been slowly absorbing the poison. It was the beginning of another royal conspiracy. Fan Jia and Xi'erei were sharing the bad luck in this department, and not even the highest position in the kingdom was spared from this devious plot. Fortunately for me, I'm just a counterfeit prince, and in 3 months I'll be tossing in my white towel to enjoy my auspicious retirement. Feng Ming patted his chest and asked in a low and cautious voice, considering the king has been poisoned, have they not caught the culprit? Slow-acting poison is extremely hard to come by, and only a handful of people in this world would know the potency of the raw materials. And for the effect to manifest after such a long time, along with the myriad of perplexing symptoms which are similar to other diseases. Even after a bout of illness, one would not detect traces with a silver needle. The cycling pattern of illness and recovery would repeat several times, two or three times usually, before death would finally overwhelm the victim. General Tong's eyebrows knitted together. Who is so bold, daring to harm the head of state, Fan Jia's king? Since it is a slow-acting poisoning, the culprits are likely people surrounding the king. Firstly, we must place hunting the murderer aside, as we must focus on our own pending issues. The old man flicked the fan he always held in his hands open, and waved it a few times before turning his attention to Feng Ming. Prince, the third princess' attitude towards Guisen is very strange, and old Xia here has figured out why there is strain between the two. Xia, please speak your mind. Official Xia rose from his seat, and with his eyebrows arched and he slowly walked concentric around the table, he finally turned to face the crowd with his opening explanation. Firstly, why would the third princess be so eager to relocate to Xi'erei? It could be that she anticipated her father having a short reign, and once the good king is dead, whether it is her first or second-in-law that takes the throne, either way would be disadvantageous for her. It is logically better that she left as early as possible and seek refuge in another country. This speculation was extremely reasonable, and everyone was obviously clear on the third princess's intelligence, and surely it didn't only cover the field of mathematics. Everyone nodded in agreement. Secondly, why would the king order the withdrawal of the army? The man paused here and gave them all a cheeky smile, leaving them to guess. Anyone have the slightest clue to why? Feng Ming and the rest bowed their heads down. A flash hit the prince instantly. Is it because of Ruo Yan? Xia applauded the prince's response. Prince, your mind is sharp and on track. Indeed, it is due to Ruo Yan's presence. General Tong pushed forth, considering Ruo Yan's sudden proposal to the third princess for her hand in marriage, it is an obvious measure to seize the throne. The great king of Fan Jia is no fool that sits ideally. The king is well aware that whatever disease he has been plaguing his body has seeped well into his vital organs and is beyond a cure. Prior to his death, he would want to see his most beloved daughter leave the country in safe passage to Xi'erei. This exchange comes with a personal favor of his withdrawal of Fan Jia's army in Xi'erei. He wishes to leave his country on the path of a prosperous future, and if Fan Jia happens to encounter any complications, there would be one more ally to lend a hand. Official Xia's one-man show successfully became a relay of input, and each participant contributed to unravel the overall situation. Even Lai Er voiced his speculation. The third princess appears as if she does not care for such worldly matters. However, she is King Fan Jia's most valuable chess piece. As long as she is in Qiai and is in favor of the crowned prince, it would be easy for any requests to send out troops to solve problems," the manservant continued. "Moreover, a large garrison of his military is currently far away from home. If the king is about to pass over, of course he would want the army to return. It would help contain any unsettlements or uprisings during the country's mourning period." Feng Ming bit his lower lip, and concluded in dismay, "That is to say, even without my stellar performance in front of the princess, she would have agreed to return with me to Qiai. Well, here I was thinking the mathematics I've retained from high school was actually useful to me." Official Xia consoled him, "Prince, why dismiss yourself in such a manner? If it wasn't for the prince's outstanding efforts in front of the third princess, how would the king feel assured in Qiai's capabilities to safeguard the princess or aid the country in need? Furthermore, he may have been compelled in accepting Ruo Yan's proposal, and only declined due to his confidence in Qiai's prince." Feng Ming was pleased with the old man's reasoning, and dimples formed as a smile eased across his lips. His brows lightened with the change in his mood and he returned to his usual lively self. If Rong Tian was by his side at this very moment, it is very likely that the man wouldn't be able to resist sneaking a kiss. The advisor went on to say, "Thirdly, there has to be motive behind why Guisan has been so accommodating." The prince was eager to show his flair, raising his hand with enthusiasm. "That's due to the possibility that Guisan also knows the grave danger the illness is placing the king in, and he is the most prospective person in line to inherit the throne. Naturally it would have him prancing around in high spirits. What's more, he'd hope we'd whisk the third princess to Qiai, which would mean he would have one less thorn in his side." General Tong shook his head in disagreement. "Prince's speculations are quite sound, but I do not feel Guisan is in a rush to have us depart. In fact, I sense he'd hope we'd stay even longer." "That's right. Ideally he would desire that we remain until the period a new king ascends the throne." Official Xia nodded and he reached for his cup of hot tea that was sitting on the table and took a sip before further commenting. "Guisan was eager to pass us the message so early in the morning, and strangely offered to escort the prince without any hesitation. This is his move to keep the envoy in a relaxed state, to assure us that Fan Jia's king's condition is not serious. In case there is truly a royal burial to take place soon, we will have to remain for the third princess's sake and we would be required to accompany her until the king has been appointed." Feng Ming was perplexed by the idea and he questioned the motive sarcastically. "Why would we need to stay? Surely they don't intend to fatten us up with their supplies and let us overstay our welcome." Official Xia suddenly lowered his voice and the corners of his lips drew upwards into a mysterious grin. "As long as I disclose one important factor to Prince, Prince would immediately understand." The old man deliberately paused, perking the attention of his listeners as they anticipated the next line. With a smile he continued, "After finding out Ruo Yan was in Fangjia, I had organized spies to monitor his whereabouts and movements. Does the prince know, after yesterday's session with the princess, where was his next destination?" The gears were in motion inside Feng Ming's brain, then his face immediately soured and he blurted out, "Guisan." "That's right. He went to see Guisan. As his proposal failed, the princess is no longer any use to him, and expectedly he would seek to ally himself with the one next in throne." Feng Ming shook his head, "That doesn't seem correct. How would Ruo Yan know that the king would die soon? Ruo Yan is a well-versed man and extremely knowledgeable, therefore there is not much that could be concealed from him. Moreover, he would have been aware of the king's medical history. Although the king's previous attacks have never been as severe this time, there would have been notable signs of the king's ailing well-being." Feng Ming nodded in agreement. Inwardly he thought, "If this is the case, Ruo Yan is indeed a force to be reckoned with. His ambitions and thirst for power gives him premise to instigate the poisoning of Fan Jia's king." The prince scrunched his face and asked the old man, "Ruo Yan and Guisan are dealing in the shadows, there's a large chance it would be matters to assist Guisan's accession to the throne." "So what if Guisan gets his seat? What does Ruo Yan receive in return? No wonder Guisan has been acting so certain that he is undoubtedly first in line. However, what I still don't comprehend is, why would Guisan need us to remain in the country? Does he have plans to harm the third princess?" It seems as if it was better he had kept his questions to himself. Once he had opened his mouth and shot his queries off like rockets, everybody's face turned stiff and stern. All their eyes stared at their master. Feng Ming blinked innocently. "What's the matter?" General Tong seemed a bit embarrassed and he turned his face away from the prince. Official Xia pinched his beard and closed his eyes. Only Lai Er didn't shy away from the question, in fact he was trying to contain his giggles. Moving closer to Feng Ming, he whispered gently into his ear, "Prince, Gui Sen isn't after the third princess, he is after you." "What? Harm me?" Feng Ming's eyes shot wide open, "What does he have against me?" Lai Er didn't give him an answer straight away, but instead gave the prince a good sizing by looking him up and down, and he clicked his tongue before responding, "Prince, when you lock eyes with people, not only Gui Sen, but even Lai Er feels like his bones have melted." General Tong swung his head back and scolded the servant's insolence, "Lai Er, you are merely a lowly attendant, how dare you address the prince in such a manner? Don't think that the prince favors you that you can disregard the difference in status." Lai Er shrunk back and bowed his head down after being reprimanded for his actions. Feng Ming tugged at Lai Er's sleeve chasing clarity, "Do you mean Gui Sen, he?" When Feng Ming thought about it, he could recall Gui Sen's eyes watching him attentively, and the man always smiled as he monitored him. The thought alone sent a chill down his neck. Lai Er shot a glance at General Tong, then again he moved over to his master and whispered, "It's not a problem for us if Gui Sen is after you, we are more afraid that you are part of his dealings. Gui Sen and Ruo Yan may have been making arrangements for the transition of the throne. One of the conditions may be your highness." "What?" Just the mere thought of being traded between the two men left him a bitter taste, and he could imagine the sinister appearance of both men during their secret meetings. Goosebumps suddenly washed over every inch of his skin, and the hairs on his body stood up simultaneously. With a shaky voice he reasoned, "That's impossible, I'm the Prince of Xi'ari, how can they dare to use me?" What came to mind was Gui Sen taking him hogtied and manhandling him over to the clutches of Ruo Yan. The scene that played out in his brain immediately left him numb. Official Xia exclaimed, "If we were to remain to see the king's funeral, Fan Jia will sooner be in Gui Sen's control, there will be no restraints on what they would dare to commit." Thump! General Tong suddenly gave the table a pounding which startled everyone. He stood up abruptly and raised his eyebrows, and in a heavy voice said, "Fan Jia is facing huge imminent changes, there is no time to lose, we must set out to leave as soon as possible." Feng Ming was still in a state of shock by the tiger's roar. Trying to settle his nerves back to resting state, however, he was the first to agree with the general. His head bobbed up and down furiously like a chicken pecking at specks of grain on the ground. He repeated, "Yes, that's right. We should take heed and leave as soon as possible. Prince is seeing the matter in the same light as your humble Xia." The official batted his fan a few times. "However, we can't just up and go as we please. We are honorary guests from afar, whom want to take the third princess away. In the least, we ought to hold a discussion with the third princess and the king before we can take leave." "All right, let's see that we pay a visit to the third princess this very night and gain her word in person that she will return with us to Xi'ari. Official Xia continued, "General Tong, if we make our move tonight and approach the princess, naturally, she would seek an audience with her father. If everything goes as planned, we could be expected to be summoned to see the king as early as tomorrow, and then we can ask to take leave directly." Feng Ming nodded, "Okay, let's do it this way." Finally, after making proper arrangements, General Tong set off in a hurry, rushing towards the third princess's residence. Volume 2, Chapter 13. Lai Er turned his focus to the old man, "Official Xia, there were two matters to be dealt with. You've finished discussing the first one, what is the second?" In a stern voice, the man replied, "The remaining issue only concerns only the prince. As a servant, Lai Er, you dare to pry?" Lai Er gave the official a disgruntled cold humph, and soon turned his attention to his master. A slight grin drew across his lips, "I know you want to have a confidential discussion. Well, I'll see myself out and carry on with my duties." Shortly after, the young man waltzed out the door and shut it attentively after his exit. He then left to seek the other servants. Feng Ming's eyes left the door and back to the remaining occupant of the room. "Official Xia, why did you intentionally target Lai Er? He was only prompting the continuation of our talk." A nasty sneer drew across the advisor's lips, "Prince, do you not feel as an attendant, Lai Er seems quite knowledgeable and overly bold for someone in his rank? Additionally, all the events he has given foresight into have proceeded with his predictions. Haven't we discussed this matter already? He may be a spy, however, as you've said, he is unlikely to bring me any harm. In fact, he may be able to even help me, so let him. Spies can be taken advantage of, but they can never be fully trusted. The old man rebutted whilst stroking his beard with concern. I am worried about Prince. Under these circumstances, you are well aware that he is untrustworthy, yet you've continued to invest your confidence in him. This, Feng Ming was genuinely surprised by his advisor's comment. Indeed, even though Feng Ming knew of Lai Er's questionable origins, he held the young man in high regard. Lai Er had an unspoken unique charm, and unknowingly everybody began to rely heavily on him. The prince was experiencing an unsettling alarm. If Lai Er was using his charisma and virtue to shuttle in between countries, indeed it would be very hard to put up a guard. Official Xia continued, up until now, Lai Er has openly showcased his talents. He is making it explicit that he is not as simple as he appears. Preciously because of this, we have taken our guards down and relaxed in his presence. Feng Ming nodded silently in agreement. He had a good point. Lai Er does seem to have a repertoire of psychological strategies up his sleeve. Official Xia was satisfied with the prince's response. The old man rekindled the need to be alert around the spy. Seeing that he had addressed the martyr, he gave his master a smile. We can discuss Lai Er at a future date. It's hard to say, perhaps Prince's charm has him wrapped around your little finger and he is indeed serving you wholeheartedly. Taking a deep breath, as for the second agenda, it's this. He paused and carefully took out something tucked inside his sleeve pockets. He held out the item and whispered, King Rong wrote a letter. Really? Feng Ming immediately jumped with joy. What did he write? Quickly, pass it to me. The moment the prince's hands reached out to snatch the letter, the old man drew back and chortled and shook his head in disapproval. Prince, compose yourself. Have you lost your sense of etiquette? Let me explain. King Rong sent 3 letters in total. Each of them has been personally addressed. One for General Tong, the second to myself, and the last was for the prince. We have already digested our individual letters in private. The prince should proceed to do so alone. The old man finally revealed the contents in his hands for taking. In his palm lay a small capsule made out of wax. Feng Ming blinked curiously as the odd container was presented to him. He reached for it and inspected the casing at a closer proximity. Walking towards a window for a source of light, he held it above him, trying to see whether there was enough transparency to hint at what may be inside. Inwardly, he cursed the king for getting up to such strange antics to send a simple letter. Naturally, he had no idea what he was meant to do with the capsule. Reacting quickly to the prince's confusion, the advisor immediately cleared his throat and began to explain. Prince, to open the capsule you'll need to knead the wax in your hands until it can be peeled back. Oh, Feng Ming followed the man's instructions and pinched the wax between his thumb and fingers under the capsule gave and split open. Interestingly, he found a lump of black gauze-like material that had been carefully wrapped. This time Feng Ming didn't require any assistance and his fingers worked quickly to unravel the expensive-looking material. As he stripped back the layers, the material was not black as he had originally thought. Instead, it was layer-open layers of words written in black ink on a near-transparent cotton gauze. When he finally finished, the letter spread out could easily cover half the top of a large table. Huh. Feng Ming was taken aback as he tried to process the extremely strange letter that lay before him. His excitement had already dissipated. Originally, he was very eager to find out what comforting thoughts the man had have written. Perhaps even how the sly bastard would write about how much he was missed and beg for forgiveness for sending him out on a diplomatic mission. Now that he had time to settle down and read, unexpectedly the densely written letter was solely composed of one word repeated. An read notes. An? What is that supposed to mean? If the king missed him excessively, shouldn't the letter be filled with Feng Ming? Then again, such a corny romantic act would never spout from the romantically challenged Rong Tian. Is it unlikely that the letter was delivered by mistake? Feng Ming's face scrunched up in frustration. Prince, Official Xia glanced at the prince's unsightly reaction and he pretty much guessed the young man was stumped to what was before him. Does the prince know of the royal rituals in praying for safety? Praying for safety, repeated slowly as he dug back into his memories, although the impression was not very deep, he did recall Rong Tian teaching him about it. Was he to blame? The prince was taught too fast and the contents way too much for him to handle. On top of the teaching process, Feng Ming was under constant harassment from the king and he was barely able to concentrate on their studies. Naturally, it would be easy for him to forget. Official Xia stepped in with his bountiful wealth of knowledge to quickly explain, a special ceremony is conducted to pray for protection for someone important. The prayer will immerse their body in pure environment for 7 days and devote themselves to a diet of vegetables. In front of God should they pray and write in religiously and repeatedly. King Rong intended to have this delivered to you so you can carry it with you at all times and remain safe. Feng Ming stared blankly and his face faintly washed with a blush. He knew his face quite easily lit up like a beacon, so he dipped his head downwards to avoid eye contact with the old man. Under his breath he murmured to himself, "Such superstitious nonsense. If you are desperate enough for these types of antics, why pressure me into leaving in the first place?" But the mere thought of the king not eating meat for 7 days softened Feng Ming, as it was a quasi-sacrifice. Feng Ming decided to give the man a break. "Prince, this letter. Although it's all superstition, at least having something prepared is better than being empty-handed. Especially, if I get requested to see that terrifying Royan." As the prince spoke, he carefully tucked his personal letter into his sleeve pocket. Official Xia gave the prince a questionable look and laughed teasingly, which only acted to escalate Feng Ming's embarrassment. Without a further word, the prince left and sought the company of his servants. In the middle of the night, General Tang, who braved the snow, was back, and he immediately made his way to see Feng Ming and Official Xia to pass on the news. "The third princess is aware of our critical situation, and tonight she will ask the King of Fanjia to meet with your highness to hasten our departure." Official Xia asked, "General Tang, when you paid an audience with the princess, did you touch upon her father's strange illness and symptoms?" "Hey." The general's face was normally righteous and friendly, but now he was revealing a sly smile. "If she read between the lines, I did secretly deposit certain details about poisonings and such. The third princess is clever and will naturally she catch on to the hints and hopefully voice her concerns to the king." Feng Ming interrupted in a boisterous manner, "Looks like Guisan is about to meet with bad luck. The king of Fanjia is severely ill, and with the country's politics as unstable as it is now, it is highly unlikely he would have Guisan executed. However, Guisan being in the line of fire is unavoidable." Lai Er let out a bout of giggles. "That's better than Guisan stalking our prince in circles." Everyone burst out in a fit of laughter, only Feng Ming remained silent and red-faced. Official Xia proceeded to ask the general another question, "Did you mention anything about the poisoning of her father and how it will induce his death soon?" "Why would I say that? If I was to tell the third princess the whole truth, would she be willing to leave Fanjia?" "That's good." Official Xia nodded his head in approval. In a blink of an eye, the old man changed the topic to uplift the mood. "Given that our prince will be summoned by the king of Fanjia tomorrow morning, it is best that we prepare our baggage for our journey ahead." "Great," they said unanimously. Each person looked at everyone else with smiles beaming off their faces, eager to start packing their baggage for the journey home. As Official Xia had speculated, the next morning a messenger was sent to the prince's hostel, and then he was sincerely summoned by the king to pay a visit at his palace. Chu Lan and the two younger maids dressed the prince carefully in a set of his finest robes, smiling as she said, "This is the last day in Fanjia, and you are going to make the king speechless when he lays his eyes on you." "Chu Lan, you make it sound like the only thing going for me is my appearance." "That's not right. There are countless men with ability in this world. However, prince with both ability and good looks is only a handful amongst these men." Chu Lan covered her mouth when she let the comment slip, but proceeded to finish, "As I said, the women in Fanjia are the most beautiful, however, the men from Xi Rei are the most handsome. I even had a wager with Chu seeing that prince would be able to scout a beautiful woman from Fanjia to become our princess." Chu Xing exclaimed after laughing, "Even if you don't bring back a princess, the third princess is a good prize to take home too." The three girls were excited to see the famous beauty of Fanjia. The more they thought about it, the higher their levels of anticipation. They began to whisper to each other of all the possibilities. Feng Ming had learned over time why the power of three women would be able to beat any of the trios he knows of from stories and history. Feeling helpless, he allowed the women to chat as they finished the final ornaments on his costume, including his saber. Considering how he had dodged all the bad luck, he was prepared to march through the gates of the palace and finish his mission. Volume 2, Chapter 14. Fanjia's Imperial Royal Palace was composed of several magnificent and distinctive red buildings. The perimeters were boldly decorated to showcase the king's grandeur. Feng Ming had led General Tang and Official Xia into the main entrance to the king's palace, but Li Er was required to remain in the carriage due to his lowly status. By this time, the heavy snowfall had stopped. But inside the palace grounds, the floor was absolutely spotless. It was obvious that the palace maids had worked towards sweeping every speck of snow off the ground. Gui San had been awaiting Feng Ming's arrival along the main hallway. Once seeing the party arrive, he scurried across to greet the prince. "Prince, we meet again." Gui San's face was beaming with a smile. His demeanor showed no signs of being disgruntled with having his companionship rejected openly the day before. The older man took Feng Ming's hands into his own, and in a grave voice he warned, "To be honest to Prince, the king's health has not been faring well in the past days. It is likely you were summoned upon the third princess's instigation. Prince needs to be cautious around that woman. She has already made arrangements with Master Dong and Ruo Yan." Feng Ming was stunned for a brief moment. Gui San was already rolling around in treachery, and now he dared to front as a friend and provoke distrust between the third princess and Shi Rei. What a despicable man. Feng Ming turned his gaze on the man, the corner of his lips jerked into a soft smile. In a low voice he replied, "Thank you, Royal Uncle, for your warnings. However, during our visit in town, we heard the people on the streets discussing the state of the king. It seems they suspect that it is not ill health consuming their king but rather a case of poisoning. Royal Uncle, you need to take care with your own meals." Although Feng Ming had only intended to toy with his uncle, it was like he had served the man a final blow. All color immediately drained from Gui San's face. The older man's mind was off somewhere momentarily before he regained his composure. He quickly asked, "Prince, where did you come across such news?" "On the streets, it's the current talk of the town." Feng Ming feigned innocence and pretended to be shocked, "Don't tell me Royal Uncle has not caught wind of this rumor." "This," the man stuttered, "this." It was obvious that Gui San was harboring a guilty conscience. Failing to talk coherently was a dead giveaway. Gui San clasped his hands in respect to the prince as he dismissed himself. "Gui San has many state matters to attend to, my apologies for not being able to accompany Prince. Please remain here as the king shall summon your presence soon." The man hurried away, most likely to investigate the word spreading amongst the people of Fangjia. Feng Ming giggled at the thought. Shortly, messengers that had left to herald the king returned. "Our king is unwell and currently needs his rest. It is unadvisable for a large audience to attend. The prince may proceed alone." "Proceed into the palace alone." General Tong was the first to lash out his dissatisfaction and looked for consensus from official Xia. He politely cupped his hands and signaled to the messengers. "Please report to the king, General Tong is under direct orders from King Rong to never leave the prince's side by even a step. With all due respects, is it possible for Tong to accompany the prince to greet his highness?" Feng Ming passed the general a glance. If the regent king had laid orders for General Tong to act as a shadow, why did he not bring up this spirit of loyalty when Feng Ming was asked to proceed alone into the third princess's inner residence? The attendant that was sent as a messenger served the king directly. He replied dutifully, "That being the case, please excuse me as I will return to seek the king's command." The man disappeared once again, and returned roughly half an hour later to address the prince. "The king is out of sorts and is no condition to see too many visitors. If the prince is apprehensive about proceeding to the palace alone, please consider seeking an audience 2 days later when the king has recovered. At that time, he would be able to hold a session in the proceedings hall where many people can be catered to." Feng Ming thought to himself, "I am afraid in 2 days I may have to visit the king in heaven." Feng Ming knew that he shouldn't delay matters, so he hurriedly flashed a signal with his eyes towards official Xia. The ball was in official Xia's court. It was up to him to decide what should happen next. The old man stroked his beard as he muttered softly, "Since it can't be helped, our prince shall pay his respects to the king of Fangjia." "But," General Tong interjected. "General Tong, there is no need to be concerned. The prince is wise, brave, and nimble. He will be safe in the palace, we can rest assured." Feng Ming's forehead was beating with sweat. Ansun was also had such characteristics, and it was also in a similar palace setting where he lost his life and his head was almost halved like a watermelon by King Rong's blade. The attendant bowed to Feng Ming. "If all is in order, may Prince please follow my lead." Feng Ming stood still in a moment of hesitation, which led to official Xia giving him a friendly joist from behind to encourage him to get a move on. Feng Ming thought inwardly, perhaps official Xia's eagerness was a sign that everything was running as expected. Most importantly, he knew it was unfitting for a prince to wimp out, just because he had to approach Fangjia's king alone. Working up the courage, his hands balled into fists, he walked forwards with his chest proudly protruding and head held high. The inner sanctuary of Fan Jia's imperial palace stood out from the smaller palaces and residences that Feng Ming had seen so far in the country. Instead of small passages leading to each building, there were large and spacious avenue-like paths. It was styled like the classical gardens of Suzhou from Feng Ming's world. Perhaps the Fan Jia Palace was also built with consideration in mathematical or celestial significance. Regardless, it was apparent that they had a great respect for natural terrain and scenery. Feng Ming continued to follow at the heels of the attendant, turning left and right on what seemed to be a complex and interweaving path. It felt like forever when they finally arrived at the bottom of the main steps outside the king's resting chamber. The long staircase was composed of beautifully polished white jade. The path threaded through two rock mountain displays. Once you surmounted the mountain pass, you were greeted with a charming entrance. Overall, one could sense the dignity, elegance, and artistry from such an arrangement. If this design was entered in a modern-day architectural contest, it would be a clean sweep of the first prize. As Feng Ming occupied himself with being amazed, two men entered the grounds by a door in the opposite direction they had come. They walked closely, one after the other. Feng Ming turned around, his face contorted in confusion as he did not expect the king of Fan Jia to have other guests. As the men closed in, he continued to stare in their direction so he could identify them. The blood drained from his face, the proud chest he held immediately deflated as if someone knocked the air out of his lungs. The man that in the lead was a palace attendant, however, it was who followed that set off Feng Ming's alarm. It was none other than Ruo Yan. A mere look from the man would make the prince freeze on cue. "Prince and he, we meet again." He cupped his hands and gave the prince a sign of acknowledgement. In fact, Ruo Yan had quickly noticed the prince and decided to join him at the bottom of the staircase. The prince had originally intended to deal with matters quickly. He didn't expect that he would come face to face with the last person he wanted to see. In fact, he had an urge to hide behind the attendant or bolt away safely. As he contemplated his next move, in a calm and collected manner, Ruo Yan shifted purposely blocked access to the staircase. Even if he wanted to, Feng Ming didn't dare to push the man aside and flee into the palace. He had to stand his ground and swallow the fear clogging his throat. He nodded his head in acknowledgement. "Is the King of Li also here to pay his respects to the King of Fan Jia?" Ruo Yan's eyes narrowed as he scrutinized the prince. A hint of a smile lifted on the corner of his lips. "I have caught word that the king is unwell. Naturally, I will be here to pay my respects. What is the prince's agenda with the king?" And he is also here to pay respects." The king clicked his tongue and teased. Ruo Yan was under the impression that prince was feeling unease in Fan Jia. "In fact, I sensed that you may be seeking the king for an earlier pardon to leave with the third princess." The man was purposely inciting Feng Ming. However, the prince could see through the man's trick. He wasn't that foolish to walk into the trap. In a cool manner, Feng Ming replied, "You are correct. And he wishes to hasten the departure. Fan Jia's rich scenery is beautiful, but and he must make haste. Xi Rei is without a leader and due to setbacks with escorting the third princess, and his accession to the throne has been postponed. It is important that I return to Xi Rei as soon as possible." Upon hearing the prince's reasoning, the king chuckled, his eyes fixed onto Feng Ming's own. The prince turned rigid, as if he was struck by a bolt of lightning. Feng Ming's heartbeat ran erratically, his eyes were wide in fear and he took a few steps back. Ruo Yan found mused with watching Feng Ming's reaction. Ending his charade, he acted as if something finally dawned on him. "Oh, I was wondering why the prince was frozen like a statue. As it turns out, I was in the prince's way. To speak bluntly, prince is also blocking my way." A cold sneer stretched across the king's lips, his words packed a double entendre. He stepped aside, and gestured with his hands. "Prince, please advance," he invited. "No, it is better that King Li takes the lead." Feng Ming declined. "Prince, I insist." Even the presence of the attendants, King Li suddenly reached out and audaciously grabbed Feng Ming's shoulders. The unwanted touch almost scared the prince out of his skin. Instead, he scrambled up onto the first step to break off the man's contact. "I will go first then," he quickly muttered. Ruo Yan chuckled and followed closely behind. "Why is this flight of stairs so long and winding?" Feng Ming felt like he was being followed by a hungry tiger. His heart would not settle, and now he was venting his problems by cursing the architecture and design of the king's inner sanctuary that he had admired only moments before his current ordeal. All of a sudden, Ruo Yan's voice interrupted his thoughts. "The sword at prince's side, Could it be the unparalleled sword? Ah. Feng Ming's voice trembled as he nodded hastily in reply, yes, it is. I didn't expect him to identify the sword with just a glance. Then it dawned on Feng Ming, if Ruo Yan knew of the sword's history and origins, perhaps he would suspect the other sword is in the Regent King's possession. The moment their swords are drawn, and if Feng Ming is struck down on the very spot he stood, this would mean the same would happen to the Regent King. Xi Rei would be in absolute chaos? Ruo Yan has ambitions to conquer the land, wasn't this scenario befitting of his wishes? The more Feng Ming pondered over the matter, it was anything but reassuring as the thoughts made the hairs of his body stand. At the same time, as he was enwrapped with his thoughts, he failed to pay attention to his footing. Ah, he choked in horror as he felt his balance slip away. Such a misfortunate mix of absent-minded treading and the winter-slicked jade surface? He was now flying helplessly backwards. From behind, a pair of strong hands clamped down on Feng Ming's lower waist. Within a flash, Ruo Yan's form pressed against the prince to cushion his fall. Ruo Yan gazed down at the prince. It was as if Feng Ming had voluntarily thrown himself into the king's arms. Prince needs to take caution, the staircase is made with white jade, given the snowfall it is a dangerous path. Ruo Yan's warm breath tickled the back of Feng Ming's ears. Their encounter was growing more and more into an embarrassing and awkward event. Feng Ming's face was so close to the man, he could see a strange look in Ruo Yan's eyes. The unwelcome stare he was receiving was sending him into panic. I know it is slippery, he muttered as he attempted to free himself. Sadly, Ruo Yan's swordsman training left him with a grip to be reckoned with. Feng Ming struggled to prostrate himself, let alone free himself from the king's vice-like hold. From afar, it would even appear as if Feng Ming was deliberately leaning into Ruo Yan's embrace. Ruo Yan didn't spare Feng Ming, teasing the prince again, Prince, you are not going to stand up. This time the king was more assertive, breaking further into the prince's personal boundary. He had pressed his lip against the ridge Feng Ming's ear. Ruo Yan blocked off the view for the attendants that were following behind. Taking this opportunity, he stuck out his tongue and gently licked Feng Ming's ear. With an audacity that only would reach the prince's ear, he whispered, I didn't expect such happenings within the hierarchy of Xi Rei's royal palace. Surely the regent king has savored you already. Feng Ming shuddered, his skin prickled as goosebumps popped up from head to toe. His face was beaming red as he gritted his teeth and glared ferociously at the king. Lowering his voice, he growled, let me go. Ruo Yan laughed at Feng Ming's attempt to bare his fangs. Oh, there is such passion in your eyes. Truly are not fit to be a prince. Perhaps the role of a lover would be better adapted. Having his fill of toying with the prince, Ruo Yan finally loosened his hands. As the deadlock was released, Feng Ming sprang from the devil's clutches. He quickly clambered up the staircase, placing a few steps of separation from the king. Feng Ming whisked his head and gave the king another death glare before bolting up the rest of the climb towards the king of Fanjia's chambers. Volume 2 Chapter 15. When Feng Ming raised the issue of an earlier departure with the king of Fanjia, he was surprised that the king readily agreed, and in a rather cheerful manner. After a series of discussions over organizing the envoy's return, the king changed the subject. He had caught word of Feng Ming's scholarly ways and couldn't resist witnessing the talent himself. News has reached the palace that Prince has deciphered one of the world's unsolved mathematical problems. Prince has shocked all by your abilities. Feng Ming felt the eyes that had been carefully watching him dig deeper like thorns against his skin. Under all the attention, he forced a smile and waved his hand in dismissal. Your Highness flatters me. However, and he should not be credited with such prestige as and he did not solve the problem. In fact, it was the Regent King who imparted his knowledge. Oh, it appears that Xi Rei's Rong Tian embodies the fearlessness of youth as well high intellect. King Rong and the King of Li are both well distinguished men, and of high caliber in skills and talents. But who would have thought that King Rong is well versed in mathematics? The King of Li smiled and replied, Ruo Yan is not deserving of such high praise. It is King Rong whom is truly extraordinary. Ruo Yan has been enlightened by the Regent King's abilities. Moreover, it was a surprise that the crowned prince also embodies scholarly intellect in addition to his attractive appearance. It can be said, they make a formidable pair. As Ruo Yan spoke, his eyes traveled in an equivocal and unscrupulous manner along Feng Ming's body. The unwelcomed attention warranted an angry glare from the prince. Whilst the Fanjia king was not paying attention, Ruo Yan seized the opportunity to toy with the prince. He flicked his tongue outwards ever so slightly and motioned a gentle lick. The croquet gesture sent Feng Ming's reflex flying. His hand shot up to protectively cup the ear that the king had licked earlier. His eyes peeled back in shock. Feng Ming's naive reaction caused Ruo Yan to chuckle. The man lifted a cup of wine to his lips, and casually imposed, "Since the prince is proficient in the art of algorithms and such, Ruo Yan would like to seek guidance in a few difficult problems." With Ruo Yan's persistent treading and provocations, Feng Ming was fuming with rage inside. Playing his cards right, he maintained a completely calm and indifferent face. A nonchalant smile spread across his lips. "Oh, certainly the outstanding King of Li does not possess problems he cannot resolve. Perhaps the purpose is to challenge Anhui's abilities." Upon hearing the words exchanged between the two young men, the King of Fangjia's interest perked. He had already noticed an odd tension between the two when they had first entered his domain. Now they were confronting each other, and what better to do than to sit on the sideline and watch the show? Ruo Yan clicked his tongue in disapproval. "How could I be as heartless as to purposely place the prince in an awkward situation? If prince is afraid, then I shall refrain from detailing the questions in mind." In this way, Feng Ming was going to lose face in front of the King of Fangjia. He gave Ruo Yan a cold snort. "King Ruo's question is." Inside, Feng Ming thought smugly, "The third princess has promised to return with me to Xi'ari. Even if I fail to answer your stupid question, it won't be a chip off my shoulder in any respects. Then I shall proceed." The smile extinguished from the king's face as he sternly gave the riddle. "There is a giant boulder, weighing 1,000 jins. There is a small child, and his arms are only able to lift 10 jins. The question is, how does the child move this rock?" Fangjia's king bellowed a hearty laugh. "This is preposterous, is it joke? How could a child barely out of his diapers shift such a heavy boulder?" Feng Ming stood dumbfounded. He had no qualms in solving the question. He was surprised that the people who seemed to be quite mathematically advanced for their time had not grasped the fundamental laws of physics. Ruo Yan had anticipated his question would stump the prince. He flashed a smug grin towards the young man's direction. It was obvious the king was purposely pushing all of his buttons. Feng Ming was at boiling point and rage had been building inside him. Now tendrils of his rage was spilling out, encouraging him to abandon the fear that Ruo Yan normally incited in him. Feng Ming furthered the moment of silence. He feigned as if Ruo Yan had deliberately made things difficult for him. His brows knitted together as if he was deep in thought. Just when everyone thought the prince would surrender and beg the king's pardon, Feng Ming suddenly clicked his tongue and shook his head with disappointment. Before solemnly replying, "Why is King Ruo asking such a simple problem? Surely this can't be the most difficult and baffling unsolved problem in the country of Li." The prince laughed. "The solution is easy. All you need is a long sturdy bamboo pole and a flat stone. The two can be used together as a lever system. The position to where the fulcrum should rest can be calculated. A lever will amplify an input force. A small child can use his body as the counterweight." Compared to mathematics, science was Feng Ming's element. As the men were dining, Feng Ming conveniently used his chopsticks as props to demonstrate the theory. His explanation was clear-cut. The two kings were astounded. In actual fact, scholars of Li had only recently made groundbreaking formulas to solve the problem and had not released the news to the academic world. Ruo Yan had intended to use his knowledge against Feng Ming, only to have it completely backfire as the prince continued to explain the solution in layman terms. He was speechless. This crowned prince was clearly not a useless simpleton as humor has it. There was a mysterious magnetism in the young man's behavior and appearance that attracted people to him. Unexpectedly, the prince had the brains to match his seamless looks. Ruo Yan pondered for a moment, before revealing the next challenge. His sly eyes lit up. Feng Ming had been monitoring the Ruo Yan and he could tell the man was up to another devious act as he caught the slight change in the king's eyes. The prince was no fool. He knew Ruo Yan was going to trouble him with another problem. As a countermeasure, Feng Ming took a preemptive strike and stopped the king in his tracks. "One hears of King Ruo's adept abilities in the field, and he has heard of an interesting mathematical problem. Would the king would be game to attempt an answer?" Given the situation, the prince had just responded to the king's supposedly advanced question. It would be embarrassing if he declined to answer one from the prince. "Please ask, prince." Ruo Yan sneered. A wealthy king wanted a new crown. He handed a craftsman 5 jins of pure gold. The craftsman was indeed a master artisan. When the crown was finished, it was worthy of gods. However, the king suspected the artisan pocketed gold when he was forging. He summoned his servants to weigh the crown, and indeed the crown weighed 5 jins. However, the king could not be entirely sure that his newly forged crown is pure gold. In fact, he suspects that his crown has been contaminated with other metals. As for the question, King Ruo, how would one determine whether the crown is gold or a composite metal formed from gold and silver? After the prince introduced the problem, the two kings exchanged bewildered looks. No one would have thought the prince would issue a complicated problem. The king of Fangjia reached to touch his own crown as he wondered whether it, too, was solid gold. Ruoyan had a useful subordinate, Master Dong, to assist him. Usually, they would be able to make a breakthrough. However, the prince's question was complicated and unfathomable. Ruoyan could not help to speculate that perhaps Shi Rei has overtaken Li in terms of mathematical scholarship and knowledge. Perhaps Li was no longer the dominant force that means his country will lose the prestige of being number one. As advanced as Li was, it was possible Shi Rei has been secretly overtaking them. A dark thought crossed Ruoyan's mind. Perhaps we will need to capture the prince and force him to spill some secrets. The young king's eyes fixed onto the prince. Feng Ming was elated with his next revelation. He was oblivious to the strange look aimed at him. Instead, he was thinking about the glory he would receive when he explains one of ancient Greece's greatest discoveries to these ancient people. Underneath the stoic face he presented, he could hardly contain himself. Trying to suppress his laughter had his stomach tying knots. Given the king of Fangjia had a daughter who was a master in mathematics, over the year he too had developed interested in the discipline. Feng Ming's question definitely held his interest. After pondering the solution, the king relented and inquired, "Such a difficult question, prince, how does one determine whether the crown is pure gold?" Feng Ming soaked his success, feeding off Ruoyan's deflating ego. In a matter-of-fact tone he replied, "Actually, it is quite simple. Your highness, which is bigger in size, 5 jins of silver or 5 jins of gold?" The king answered with no delay, "Naturally, it would be 5 jins of silver. Then if you mix silver and gold, that means the alloy would be larger than just solid gold. That is spot on. However, even if an alloyed crown is heavier, the king's crown was designed with intricate carving details. How does one differentiate whether the crown was conveniently carved down to the appropriate size and weight?" Feng Ming clapped his hands excitedly. If the king would be as kind as to organize 2 identical basins and have them filled to the brim with water. Once you place your crown and 5 jins of pure gold, you shall receive an answer. Ruoyan is an intelligent man, thus even without a demonstration, the solution immediately clicked in his head. However, his face was plastered with astonishment. There was an intensity in his eyes as he stared at the young man in awe. Such a simple and strange method to solve such a difficult problem was entirely foreign and unheard of. After a further lengthy 2-hour discussion in the king's chambers, Feng Ming not only obtained permission to set off the next day, he also gained victory over the king Ruo. The man suffered a complete defeat, with his tail between his legs. Feng Ming wore his triumph with stride, as he marched out of the palace gates. Catching sight of their prince, General Tong, official Xia, and Li Er immediately swarmed towards him. "Prince, what was the outcome?" "Oh, actually, when I was on my way to see the king, I encountered the king of Li, Ruoyan." Feng Ming sounded dejected. "What?" General Tong's face was pale with alarm. He persisted, "Was Ruoyan's intention to interfere and create problems? Perhaps he has blocked Prince's departure from Fangjia," official Xia added. The two men's complexion had seen better days, their face were solemn and anticipating an answer from their prince. Both were deeply repenting for not accompanying the prince. "About that?" He wore a poker face and teased in a stern voice. Feng Ming calmly observed the two men's nervous behavior before giving away the game in a loud burst of giggles. "Haha, I am going to die of laughter. Get inside the carriage and I will explain the rest." Once the men loaded themselves on the carriage, Feng Ming explained the happenings in chronological order. As he vividly recounted the events that folded out, he guffawed endlessly. When he reached the part describing Ruoyan's complete embarrassment, he almost fell off his seat. "Don't you guys think it's hilarious too?" Feng Ming prompted as he hugged his stomach. Feng Ming was the only one giggling away at his story. The three men had listened on with gripping concern. Their faces only showed dismay. They exchanged glances before official Xia finally broke their silence. "This strange method of solving the problem, how in the world did Prince conceive such a solution?" General Tong followed, Surely such a technique is our country's national treasure, yet Prince so casually divulged this information to a tyrannical man like Ruoyan. I am more afraid that Prince has made his abilities apparent. Ruoyan will not let you off the hook for his shame. Lai Er bit his lower lip and spoke in a timid voice. Feng Ming didn't take offense from the trio's doubts, instead he thumped his hand against his chest and proclaimed, "Nothing to fear, I am well versed in many disciplines, water displacement and density calculations are merely a scratch on the surface of what I know. Anyhow, scientific knowledge should be shared to allow for advances. As for the King of Li, Ruoyan." The mere thought of the man reminded Feng Ming of the king's inappropriate behavior. Feng Ming trembled with the mental backflashes but forced the imagery out of his mind. Consoling himself, he muttered softly, "Regardless, we will be leaving for Fangjia tomorrow. If he dares to approach Xi Rei and tries to make an advance at me again, Rong Tian will exterminate him." "What advance?" the three men shouted out in unison. Feng Ming would rather die than have such an embarrassing thing out to public, so he quickly dismissed any notions of being molested. "No, you guys are jumping to conclusions." When the prince returned to the hostel with his small party, the positive news quickly spread, evoking uproars of happiness. After all, everyone had been away from home for a long time. Everyone was yearning to return to their homeland. Messengers were also sent to inform the third princess of the departure, asking her to meet the envoy at the main gates of the city. They will finally leave for Xi Rei. It was an occasion to be celebrated. That evening a big feast was held. General Tong brought out two enormous jars of expensive and high-quality rice wine. They were gifts from the King of Fangjia. Upon laying his eyes on the prized alcohol, official Xia smoothly gravitated towards them. Chu Lan and the other servants were encouraged to join in the festivities. General Tong also insisted Feng Ming try the rare wine. Since discovering Lai Er in between his bed sheets the last time he drank, Feng Ming was firm about not drinking alcohol. However, his determination was extremely weak against peer pressure. His cheeky maids urged him on and Lai Er was beside him, coaxing cup after cup. His low alcohol tolerance emerged once again. First he lost his sense of direction and then he suffered a complete blackout. The prince suddenly woke in the middle of the night, his head in a daze as the drunkard stupor was beginning to wear off. At least they had tucked him in. However, his eyes flicked open as soon as he sensed something was out of line. Turning on his bed, he found himself looking into large glassy eyes. "You are in my bed, again," Feng Ming shrieked. The familiar face was sharing his sheets. Lai Er had not been asleep. The young man blinked innocently. "Prince, it's not my fault. You are being unreasonable. I was in charge of escorting Prince to rest, yet when Lai Er tried to leave Lai Er was tugged down and held tight. Prince was crying and kicking and demanding I stayed." Feng Ming was exasperated. He scolded, "Didn't I give orders to douse me with cold water to wake me up?" Lai Er shook his head. "No, not on a cold day, the prince can easily fall sick. Let me get ill, it is better than forcing you into bed," he exclaimed. With tomorrow set for departure, wouldn't the prince falling to illness be the last objective? His servant reasoned. That, Feng Ming was speechless. Damn, the boy had a point. Moreover, Lai Er behaved, prince can check and see that Lai Er is still wearing his undergarments. With that said, his servant playfully grabbed his hand under the sheets and ran it down his clothed body. Feng Ming quickly flung his hand out of the boy's grip and gently pushed the other's body back. "No touching, no contact," he enforced. Suddenly, Feng Ming noticed Lai Er's face was contorted in discomfort. He moaned loudly in pain. The prince had no idea what he had triggered. "What's wrong, Lai Er?" "Nothing." Lai Er lied between gritted teeth and he shook his head for a faulty attempt at reassurance. Hearing his reply and seeing the boy's facial reaction, Feng Ming was not convinced. Riding on his suspicions, he prompted, "Are you sick?" "No, it's nothing." "Then why are you guarding your chest?" "Let me have a look." "Don't mind me, Your Highness." Being told not to care about his subordinate, Feng Ming was driven to find the answer. He was pretty confident that Lai Er was trying to conceal something from him. With a loud snort of defiance, he stated, "The more you deny me, the more I want to see." Using new grappling techniques he had learned from Rong Tian, Feng Ming wrestled Lai Er into a submissive position. The young man tried to wriggle his way out. He gasped in pain, his face waning in color before he finally submitted and asked for mercy. "All right, Lai Er will let Prince see, but please do not ask anything. Lai Er will keep his mouth shut. The servant finally removed the hand he held protectively over his chest. Feng Ming reached between the openings of his garment and felt his chest. To his surprise, the young man's chest was bound in thick layers of gauze. "You are hurt," he swallowed in shock. Lai Er nodded. "When did you get this injury? Who did this to you?" Lai Er looked at his master dearly. His eyes were smiling as if they seemed to reflect what was on his mind. "Look, you are already asking a million questions." Feeling moisture at his fingertips, Feng Ming exclaimed, "This is terrible. You are bleeding profusely." Lai Er immediately reached to cover his master's mouth and said, "Your Highness, don't be so loud. We have to redress your wound right now," he insisted. Lai Er sighed, resigning to his master's doting. "The medicinal herbs are in my room." In a valiant manner, Feng Ming immediately volunteered, "I will fetch it for you. People can't know about this, please, Prince." Feng Ming recalled that Lai Er was a man of suspicion, perhaps the reason why he was hurt. Lai Er was very sensitive to the change in the prince's eyes. He voiced himself, "Does Prince suspect Lai Er of wrongdoing?" "That's not the—" Lai Er interrupted him, his eyes staring sternly into his own. "Prince," Lai Er said cordially, "please believe Lai Er. Lai Er will never harm Prince." Feng Ming peered into Lai Er's eyes. The boy was watering up. He nodded. "I believe you. I believe that you will never harm me. Okay, I will sneak out and retrieve your medicine." He briskly climbed out of bed and draped a cloak around his slender form to brace the cold outside. His footsteps were soft as he made his way towards Lai Er's room. There was no snow on this night, but the winter winds were unrelenting. As soon as he opened his bedroom doors, the wind bombarded his exposed cheeks and sent chills up and down his body. Cautiously, he tiptoed his way to Lai Er's room. Once he was inside, he rummaged through the young man's belongings. Sure enough, he found medicine and wrappings. However, there were also a few questionable items and artifacts. Perhaps these are contraptions that a spy would use in this era. Lai Er had a certain gift, one wanted to trust his every words. Feng Ming had surprised himself. He had wholeheartedly believed him. Wanting to return to help his servant, he quickly grabbed the items and left. Stepping back out to the hostile weather, Feng Ming thought inwardly, certainly everyone is nice and cozy in their beds in this forsaken weather. Only this sneaky prince was out prowling the darkness, but what if he was mistaken for a thief? On that thought, a flash of movement suddenly caught the corner of Feng Ming's eyes. He barely whisked around to catch the shadow of a tall blackened man. Feng Ming's eyes were going to pop out of the socket. When he wanted to scream for help, the black figure's hand clamped down tightly over his lips, immediately extinguishing his voice. The tall and threatening stranger had raided the prince's temporary residence and dared to attack the prince of Xi'ari. Under whose command was this assailant working under? What a miserable end. Regret washed over the prince. Maybe he should have kept his mouth shut instead of parading his victory over Ruo Yan. Did the king take offense? Was this an assassin to root out the trouble? Oh, God, what kind of torture was he in for? With his thoughts running a mile a second, Feng Ming was feeling lightheaded. The strong man kept his hand firmly over the prince's mouth. The other hand pinned the young man's hands behind his back. The stranger's form was pushing against him, leaving no room to maneuver. The hidden eyes stared into Feng Ming's panic-stricken ones. He pressed his masked face against the side of the prince's ears and bit down lightly. The masked man softly laughed. "Did you miss me?" teased a familiar voice. As soon as the man whispered into Feng Ming's ear, the prince's world was shaken upside down. His hands that were bound tightly were suddenly freed. Feng Ming flipped around and punched the man hard in the stomach. Through gritted teeth he scolded, "Rong Tian, you bastard, I—" Before he could finish chewing his lover out, Rong Wang's hand snapped over his mouth again. Feng Ming was scared half to death, he even had tears welling up. His fist pounded against Rong Tian's chest endlessly. Rong Tian pulled down his mask to expose the handsome and chiseled face that Feng Ming had yearned for. The taller man removed his hand from his lover's mouth and quickly replaced it with his own to smoother the prince's rage. The little prince continued to thump fists against the king's chest. Nothing could ever beat the taste of the prince's soft and sweet lips. Once their lips touched, they battled and attacked each other with their tongues. The anger inside Feng Ming was turned into a fevered passion. Rong Tian gave his lover a thorough oral inspection as his techniques melted the prince into a wanton mass. Their contact broke only when Feng Ming was beginning to suffocate. Now that the prince's anger was sedated, he allowed himself to be held in the king's embrace. In the dead of the night, King Rong pulled his lover in the shadows of a corner out of sight from passerbys. Why are you here all of a sudden? Once I caught news of King Ruo's presence in Fangjia, I immediately set off. How can I allow you to be thrown into a pit with a vicious wolf? He flashed Feng Ming a doting smile, and pulled the young man closer. What about Xi Rei? No one knows that I have left, it won't be an issue as long as we get back at God's speed. Once we return, you will ascend the throne. Even General Tong and official Xia are in the dark. Yes, there is no need to let anyone else know about my presence in Fangjia. Otherwise it will be dangerous. Feng Ming pointed out his flaw, then why are you telling me that you are supposedly in hiding? I am telling you now, I am quite stupid. I won't be able to hide you well. Now, how is my little prince stupid? The prince's abilities and intelligence has shocked the world. He praised. Rong Wang grinned, as he fondly bit his favorite spot on Feng Ming's ear. As for keeping concealed, that's not much of a challenge. All I need to do is to hide in the prince's bed. It was the prince who taught me that every moment of a lover's tryst is precious. Rong Tian grabbed his hand and pulled him towards his bedroom. In my bed? Then it clicked. Feng Ming had been so engrossed with seeing his lover to the point that his mind had completely blanked out on his original objectives. Now that they were heading towards his bed, Feng Ming remembered Lai Er? Lai Er who was lying partially undressed in his bed? As he was dragged to the door, Feng Ming broke into a cold sweat. Volume 2 Chapter 16. Rong Wang was on the verge of making his way through the doors when Feng Ming moved with lightning speed to barricade him. His reaction speed was akin to a cat that had its tail treaded on. Don't go in. Rong Wang was baffled by his sudden insistence. Why? He asked his eyes boring down onto his lover. Because, Feng Ming's frantic eyes locked onto Rong Tian's own, his hands reached to dab at the sweat beading off his forehead. That's because my sleeping pallet is not big enough for the two of us to share. He nervously observed Rong Wang's reaction in fear the man was suspicious of his hidden agenda. Rong Wang cast a fleeting confused look at the closed doors, then, as if it suddenly dawned upon him, a gentle smile grew from his lips. Is that so? He commented before he stepped forwards and sandwiched the prince between him and the cold wood of the entry. His large hand reached up to lightly caress Feng Ming's lips, before bending his own to spoil them with a soft kiss. He pulled the young man into his arms. Standing outside at this temperature is turning you to ice. Rong Tian's seductive magnetism quickly distracted Feng Ming's initial motives of his guilty conscience. If the bed is unfitting, why don't you rest on top of me? With that said, Rong Tian kicked the doors open and whisked the prince inside. He lifted the boy effortlessly into his arms before striding towards the bedchamber. The warm air moved like currents embracing their chilled forms. The room was fragrant and threads of smoke danced in the air from the daily incense that Chu Lan had set alight. Soon the pair was directly across from the bed in which Lai Er laid. The bed is spacious enough. The king judged, glancing down at Feng Ming who was nestled in the crook of his arms. Feng Ming's heart could just about bungee jump from his chest, his face paled. As long as you feel it is big enough. Inwardly, he added, three will be a crowd. The delicate tassels highlighted the fine drapery that hung on the bed frame creating a private cloaked space for within. It was this cover that was prolonging the agony. Feng Ming watched Rong Tian in gripping silence as the older man carried him step by step closer to where an imminent storm brewed, spelling his doom. He prayed. God, I hope Lai Er was smart enough to hear us and made his way out without a trace. Please be an empty bed. It has to be an empty bed, otherwise I am a dead man. With his eyes shut and deep in prayer, a soft and attractive voice waffled from behind the partition. Prince has finally returned, why was Prince out for such a length of time? Rong Tian halted in his footsteps with the unexpected voice. He coldly stared at the drapes before slowly turning his attention to the man in his arms and giving Feng Ming a condescending look. The eyes glaring into him made Feng Ming tremble with fear. His guts harbored a foreboding feeling that Rong Tian would violently rape him as punishment. Even if he didn't have sex with Lai Er, Rong Wang would never believe him. Grotesque and disturbing images of sick and twisted revenge taken out by jealous men from ancient history flashed in Feng Ming's mind. Oh, he trembled from top to toe. Rong Wang issued him a deceiving smile before gently asking, Feng Ming, are you cold? You are shivering. The fake sincere smile the king was fronting was a hundredfold more dangerous than any threat from Ruo Yan. This is a disaster. What a cruel world. Is this the calm before the tempest? Feng Ming's primal instinct had him close his eyes tight, Like an ostrich, he buried his face into the crook of the king's arms. Rong Tian chuckled suggestively, prompting the prince to rest on the bedside. One hand reached to lift the drapes to reveal Lier. The servant was in a simple tunic, his body reclined on the bed with one white jade-like arm propping up his head. The boy's childlike eyes met with the intensive glare of the king. Feng Ming held his breath, his thoughts in conflict. Should I or shouldn't I help Lier? If I save him, it would be even harder to wash away this misunderstanding. If I don't do anything, why are you here? Demanded an unimpressed Rong Tian. Caving into the tremendous mental pressure, Feng Ming could cry. He shied away from the bed. I don't know anything, the prince proclaimed. Lier's reaction was to the contrary. In a calm manner, he lifted the quilt and slipped out of the bed to kneel obediently at the king's feet. In a small voice, he made grace. Lier pays his respects to his master. Today is the prince's last day in Fangjia territory. Lier is worried, so stayed watchfully beside his highness. The young servant lifted to glance at the regent king's expression. Seeing that there was no overt expression, he laughed playfully. Lier has not done anything. Prince belongs to the master. Lier dares not meddle. I will forgive you for not daring. You have grown. However, you are still so mischievous and frivolous, nothing like your mature brother. King Rong gave a cold snort. Have you settled matters in Yongyin? Lier received master's instructions and secretly arranged to exterminate his post. Ensuring that no trace is left to doubt my disappearance in Yongyin, the king of Yongyin truly believes I have died of illness. He replied dutifully. The king made a sound of approval. You have been carrying out espionage in Yongyin long enough, it was time you returned to Xi'ari. Rong Tian nodded and then turned his attention to the prince that sat stupefied on the sidelines. Feng Ming, I will let you know, I have assigned my best men to safeguard you. You have met Rong Hu. Although Lier is naughty, he is quick-witted and adept at dealing with contingencies. I feel a little peace of mind to know they are by your side. Thump. Feng Ming? Feng Ming. Rong Tian's deep voice permeated the room as he looked at the prince in distress. Master, it appears the prince has fainted. ... The next day, the envoy from Xi'ari finally departed with an additional member, the third princess. Their departure was majestic and grand. However, during this period it was said that the prince had fallen ill. In the carriage he settled in seclusion to nurse his ailments along the beginning of a long journey home. It appears when the prince was sick he had a bad temper. From time to time one could hear him curse along with the various sounds of objects being smashed. Not to mention the sharp sound of skin being slapped. For everyone on the outside, they all inwardly awed by the male chamberlain on the receiving end of the abuse. Curiously, each time Lier left the carriage he was unscathed, completely without even a slightest bruise on his face. After 3 or 4 days the bitter chiding and cluttering of random items died down. Instead, they were now replaced with interesting moans that made people blush. The curtains that decorated the carriage in winter were thick and far from transparent. One could only listen on and imagine what was taking place inside. Chu Lan, listen, they are, giggled Chu Yu. They are what? Lier is good looking, it's only natural the prince would give into temptation. Chu Xing commented. Well, it's not like I am saying anything about it in particular, but I am afraid someone might feel, teased Chu Yu before Chu Xing slapped her on the shoulder. Pouting as she scolded, don't make fun of me. The prince's business with Lier has nothing to do with me. Chu Yu choked back her laughter before giving her playmate what she wanted to hear. Yes, yes. It's not any of our high and mighty Chu Yu's business. Nonetheless, how would the regent king handle the matter when we return to Xi'ari? On the other hand, General Tong ushered his horse to stride beside Official Xia's to ask a question that has been bothering him. Official Xia, we've been on the road for 4 days yet the prince has not shown his face this. Official Xia waved, battered his fan back and forth, stroked his beard and explained, a journey can be lonely, Lieris a rare specimen. Would General Tong be so eager as to dampen the prince's leisure? But if this persists, I am afraid there will be detrimental effects to the prince's body. No ailments shall reign over the prince's body as long as Official Xia is around, General Tong can rest assured. The matter was settled and the party continued to travel day and night for another 2 days, where they finally left the borders of Fangjia. They will now travel through Yongyin for another 7 days before they would reach Xi'ari.